Hi there, this is a short video about how I make my front panels. Some examples you see here. I don't know about you, but I do like to give my projects that little touch to make them look reasonably good in the lab. I've been doing this for years. The front of this old function generator is more than 10 years old and still looks good. More recent are my collection of reference standards, where I settled on a type of housing and a standard socket layout and just produced them over the course of probably 2 years or so. I did it this way because some of my high precision components are very expensive, so building separate boxes over time spreads the cost and it allows me to prioritize the ones I wanted more urgently. I do check my multimeters twice a year or so, that's when these come out, or when friends bring their meters over. As you can see on this resistor box, I recently changed the circuit to include a 100 megohm resistor after I finally got a meter that could measure such high resistances. But I did not bother making a new front panel and did a handwritten amendment. In most cases, I use protective foil on my front panels. In some instances, like these two, I use lamination because it makes it very easy to add transparent windows for displays. Lamination is more work and more expensive. In this video I concentrate on the foil method, but I'm planning to do a project needing a lamination front plate soon. The making of it will become part 2 of this video. The most recent front plate was this one on the high walls DC generator, which is actually a lamination because I needed to laminate something else as well and there was still space in a lamination pouch, so it was no extra cost to add this front panel. The front panel I'm going to use to show the process is this one. That project is actually complete, but I have not finished a video on it yet. So probably the video following this one will be about building this project. But for now you have to be content with just its front panel. I always design my front panels using a drawing program, in this case LibreOffice Draw, which is part of the LibreOffice suite and free, but any drawing program will work as long as it allows you to create true scale drawings. What I mean is that if I draw a box of dimensions 100 by 75 millimeters in the program and then print it, the box on the paper copy has exactly these dimensions. Some of the elements are given and depend on your choice of the box. For example, this box has a front panel of 100 by 75 and I use the ruler to get the positions of the existing holes for the screws attaching it to the rest of the body. Speaking of those screws, when designing the front panel layout, you must remember that there are those posts where the screws will go and stay sufficiently clear of them with your components. If your drawing program supports layers like this one, you can use them to create a layer that contains helper lines to ease placing components neatly and symmetrically. In this case, the box will be a tight fit and I found it useful to add the dimensions of the switch and the circuit board and its mounting holes to ensure that everything will fit and not clash with the sockets, which are these big holes here. Once you're happy with the arrangement, you can hide the helper lines and see how the panel will print out. For the covering, I use a clear self-adhesive protective film meant for protecting books. It's called Tensa and available in UK stationery shops like Ryman. A 0.5 meters by 5 meters roll costs about £5 and will last you ages. They also sell smaller quantities. For smaller designs like this panel, I usually put a couple on the same sheet of paper to have a spare if I mess things up. Then I cut a piece of foil slightly larger than the front panels. Once you manage to get hold of the back cover, I start peeling it off and at the same time transfer the transparent film onto the printout, trying not to create wrinkles or bubbles. This one I got on slanted and I almost ran out of foil, but just made it. The next job is to cut a panel out with a pair of scissors and punch the holes needed for switches, sockets, screws and the like. For both foil covered and laminated front panels, punching holes works far better than cutting with a knife or using an electric drill, which shreds both the hole and the surrounding area. I found using a single hole punch like this one works best. They are available in different sizes. This is the largest size I found for 8mm holes. They all have this flap to collect the punched out paper confetti, but I recommend unclipping and removing it. With a bit of gentle persuasion using a screwdriver, it is possible to unclip the flap. You could add it back later, but I normally leave it off because without it, the puncher can be much better centered on the target area. By using the hole punch upside down without the collecting flap, you can easily change the position to precision target where the hole should go. Laminated front panels can be punched directly, but don't do it for foil as I did here accidentally because it will leave creases and wrinkles in the panel. Instead, I recommend to put a piece of cardboard under the foil covered front panel before punching to prevent the crumpling. Okay, this hole is crumple free, but it did not quite get where it should have been, but it can be easily reworked and the wider rim of the banana socket will gracefully cover small imperfections like that. By the way, the tiny holes you see are from using the printout to transfer the position of the holes onto the plastic enclosure for drilling. While the single hole punch is the easiest method, it has its limits too, and one of them is obviously its limited reach. There are some holes that are just too far inside. There is, of course, this type of hole punch with a slightly larger reach, but only for a maximum diameter of 4.5 mm, so you would need to use it several times to nibble a larger hole. And then there are these bad guys. You can get them for quite large diameters. Obviously, you won't have restrictions in reach anymore. You pick the closest size for the target and get ready for the action. I use these on a cutting mat and you need to put a cardboard piece below to prevent crumpling. Then a few pretty strong hits with a hammer. And there's the punched out hole. In most cases, the front panel printout is held naturally in place because the rims of sockets, binding posts and switches are wider than the holes, and so tightening the rear nut of a socket will ensure that the front printout won't be able to move. However, in cases where there is a relative wide area with no sockets or switch and around the corners, I use a few dabs with standard strength glue stick to prevent the printout from lifting from the front plate. Here you can see the rear with the preparation for mounting the PCB. And this is the fully assembled and wired up unit. As you can see, it is reasonably tight and also uses the full depth of the box to give the PCB sufficient clearance from the front sockets. More about this little device in an upcoming video. For now, that's it on foil covered front panels for me. Thanks for watching.